In the last half century, we've seen incredible progress in reducing gender inequality around the world. But there is still a long way to go. Nowadays, policymakers have a large toolkit at their disposal to promote gender equality and support inclusive growth. Most people are aware of changes to women's legal rights and to policies ensuring opportunities to access education and equal pay. So where does tax policy come in? I'm Maria Coelho of the IMF's Fiscal Affairs Department, and I'm here to explain how taxes can be biased and how changing them can foster gender equality. Historically, many tax systems were explicitly biased, with provisions legally linked to gender. This type of explicit bias is getting rarer. But even when tax systems are nominally neutral, most still have some type of implicit bias. That can happen when labor, capital, or consumption taxes interact with underlying economic characteristics or circumstances to reinforce or correct gender inequality. In this sense, the taxation of labor income has the biggest impact. For example, since women tend to be overrepresented at the bottom of the income distribution, progressive tax systems can help reduce gender gaps in labor income through redistribution and by strengthening employment incentives. Another key factor is the unit of taxation, essentially whether taxes are levied at the individual or household level. Historically, a family structure was considered to be a working husband, a stay-at-home wife, and multiple children. Household taxation was seen as a way to benefit these families and to encourage marriage and fertility. In our work, we confirmed that family-based systems disincentivize secondary earners, who are still often women, from working. This is because the share of income of a secondary earner who is married to someone earning much more is taxed at a higher marginal tax rate than if they were single. As you can see from these figures, the shortfall in women's labor force participation relative to men's is smaller in purely individual tax systems. But because family systems reduce the average tax burden for the household as a whole, simply allowing for optional individual filing won't be enough to prevent the tax bias perpetuating one-earner families. It needs to become the only tax filing option. What economists discuss less often is the interaction of capital income taxes and gender inequality. Women are underrepresented at the top of the capital income distribution, even more so than for labor income. And although discriminatory legal environments for property and asset ownership are increasingly a thing of the past, the gender wealth gap today is still substantial. This unequal distribution of capital income is compounded by typically lower taxes on capital income. So while there is an ongoing debate on how to tax income from capital versus labor, the gender perspective does provide an argument for greater capital income taxation. This includes taxes targeting wealth, like inheritance and property. And in our work, we found that countries with stronger inheritance or property rights for women also tend to have higher inheritance tax rates or property tax revenues as a share of GDP, which you can see on this chart where countries are grouped in three categories of gender equality and ownership rights. We see a very similar pattern in special consumption taxes when consumption patterns of socially costly goods are different across genders. For example, we find that tobacco taxes are particularly low in countries where smokers are predominantly male. But broadly speaking, consumption taxes are considered to be gender neutral, even though their true incidence can be hard to measure, since spending surveys are usually conducted at the household level. Think, for instance, that it is nearly impossible to distinguish if a bag of rice or internet service is consumed by the men or women in the family. But for some goods, like feminine hygiene products, the distinction is easier. They have received special attention recently, as several governments have attempted to improve access to these basic necessities through value-added tax rate cuts. While there are good reasons to avoid reduced rates in value-added taxes in general, when they already exist for necessities, feminine hygiene products should be included in that essential category. And as many as 25% of emerging and developing economies and 39% of advanced economies already do that. But it is important to note that such policy alone is actually not very effective and also benefits well-off women. And given the relatively small share of taxes in the retail costs of these goods, true affordability could be provided to those who really need the help by instead taxing all goods uniformly and using those revenues to give low-income women free or highly subsidized products directly. Taxes are not necessarily the best tool to address each and every source of gender bias. But as long as our economies are not fully equitable, they can exacerbate or mitigate such inequities. So the consequences of the policies we choose can still make taxes a gendered word.